African Affairs Analyst from London, Germaine Sonwolu. Thank you very much for joining us this hour. Let's start with that little bit of information there as to this deal now, quote and unquote, between Mugabe and the army. What would even be gained if they choose to prosecute the 93-year-old man?
Well, thanks a lot for having me today. Well, a lot would have been gained in setting an example to other African leaders or leaders of the world who see political power as their own, or actually feel that it can actually be a kind of dynasty where they can pass it from one member of their family to the other. To have set an example for war criminals who call themselves presidents, who have committed so much evil to their people, and that is what would have been an example to them, to show that you cannot get away scot-free for doing something evil. And that would have inspired a new generation of leaders in Africa to actually do the right thing, because they know they will be accountable. Now, he negotiating with the army was actually a wise move, and I'm sure they will actually want to ensure that his exit is actually smooth and doesn't cause a lot of trouble, because you must know that Robert Mugabe actually had a lot of supporters, one, and they didn't want to cause any kind of violence to try and see that the military has taken over and there's a lot of problems, but also to ensure that there is peace in the land. This was someone who was actually respected, very, very well respected in his country, being a liberator, but now has become a dictator. He was he's also respected in the African Union as someone who stood against white oppression. So he negotiating a kind of immunity from persecution is a smart one, because he knows he has committed a lot of crimes.
Well, Germaine, because this wasn't a proper coup, negotiations had to have taken place, and no doubt immunity would have been the ultimate condition. But rights groups are going to try to prosecute ministers who worked under Mugabe. How do you now prosecute the body without prosecuting the head?
That's a very, very good question, because if you're going to persecute the ministers, you're actually going to persecute MSN Mnangagwa, who is actually going to be the vice president, and who was former vice president, who's going to become the president-elect come Friday, because they were all complicit in this. They all actually carried this act out, and you can say that they were actually acting on instructions from the top, which is Robert President Mugabe. So you have to deal with him before you deal with others. But what I believe is going to happen in Zimbabwe right now is that they're actually going to try and just put an end to what has happened in the past, and actually going to and just start on a new leaf, and actually just, in a way, so to say, forget about what has happened and say, let's move forward as the new president who's going to be coming in. Emerson Mnangagwa actually said that, you know, let's have a new democracy. This was someone who was known as the crocodile before. Let's see how he's going to now appease and actually going to do more good with those ticks that once bite people. Would he be able to bite corruption, bite poverty, and bite the pains of many Zimbabweans of the past administration away with his crocodile teeth?
And Germaine, what could change now that Mugabe has exited after such a long reign? Of course, like you've already established, Emmerson Mnangagwa is still part of the system and is said to even have this same authoritarian tendencies.
Yeah, he did have a lot of authoritarian tendencies. He oversaw a lot of activities that Mugabe actually did. He was a defense minister, and he did a lot of atrocities when it comes to the Ndebele tribe. You understand, there was a lot of persecution, a lot of deaths that occurred. But let's believe right now that if a military leader can become a president of one of Africa's most populous nations, and also we should also believe that now someone who was a crocodile dictator can actually become a born-again president who is now going to allow a new system of change for Zimbabwe. A lot of things has to be expected from this country right now. A lot of change is actually being demanded, because you must know that Zimbabwe was known to be called the breadbasket of Africa. People are calling it a basket case right now, but let's hope it's a basket case that's actually becoming better. It's rich in natural natural resources, gold, platinum, diamond. The diamond is estimated to be up to $15 billion in their economy just a few years ago. It has done a lot. But right now, what we see in Zimbabwe, the situation whereby in 2008, they had 231 million percent of inflation rate. And in 2015, it was recorded that one Zimbabwean, you had to have 351 quadrillion Zimbabwean dollars to just get one US dollar. Okay. So we should actually be thanking God in Nigeria that things are not so bad. You know, we actually have to look at that. Zimbabweans need change. And hopefully this man who has a past of bad tendencies will come and now bring in new change to the country that desperately needs it.
Well, let's hope that is to be. Well, Mugabe finally jumped before he was pushed, thank goodness, and Mnangagwa is going to be sworn in tomorrow, that's Friday. But something that intrigues me is he promised to be back to the country to make Zimbabwe a more democratic country. Do you think he had a premonition of what the military was going to do?
Well, I believe he actually knew what the military was going to do if he didn't actually orchestrate it while he was in exile. You must know that, as I said, he was a defense chief and he had a lot of strong allies with the military. What Mugabe actually, the mistake he made was that he let his selfish ambition take over the strategic vision that he had for Zimbabwe. Being a liberator, he became a dictator, and also now trying to let his wife, Gucci Grace Mugabe, as they call her, try and supersede him or take over him and have a Mugabe, so to say, dynasty in South Africa. He forgot the strongest man in power that was actually supporting him was his defense Emmerson Mnangagwa, and he actually let go of that man. He fired him. The allegation that actually poisoned him, and the man's life was under threat. So the man, once he was kicked out, I'm sure that he orchestrated this whole thing to ensure that there's an end of this sort of brutal and dictatorial rule in Zimbabwe. So I'm sure he had a part to play in all this, but luckily the military intervened in what they called not a coup, and they actually ensured that Zimbabweans, their desire has actually come to reality. Their dreams of a new Zimbabwe is actually being birthed.
Jermaine, you've also said at the onset that Zimbabweans might just move on, but then you talk about Gucci Grace. How does the average Zimbabwean now, this incoming government now, forget Grace? What should be done with her?
Let's hope that they will give Grace, or they will show grace to Gucci Grace, but it's actually going to be quite hard, because you see the allegations will be of widespread looting by this family. The G40 cabal that actually took over Zimbabwe was known to have committed a lot of crimes, one against humanity, pushing and suppressing opposition leaders, but also when it comes to criminal offenses in looting public funds. So right now Mugabe has actually said that he doesn't want to seek, he doesn't want to go on exile, that he wants to die in Zimbabwe. There were some of the conditions in the negotiations that he had. There were some insinuations that he may go and stay in South Africa, but this is a man who is very full of pride, and he said he wants to die in a country that he fought to liberate from white minority rule. But Grace Mugabe right now has a lot on her plate. I believe at one point in time she may just have to leave for her own safety and for her own sanity, because she has done a lot of harm to that country and intended to do much more. They believe that Mugabe was surrounded by people like her and other bad people that tried to bring out the country, but he's not exempt from actually having a role in it. But she has to actually consider her own future when Mugabe dies eventually.
There's a confusion there now, because I was going to take you up on Grace having to leave while Mugabe still exists, but I'm not sure if Mugabe could have negotiated any kind of immunity without including his wife, you know, in that agreement or negotiation. But do you think Mnangagwa can deliver a broad-based government?
Well, I believe that he has to. He must, he has no choice, because Zimbabwe needs that change right now. They are a country that, you know, Nigeria has oil, but they were an example of a country that can harness its natural resources and actually do a lot of great things with that raw material, that earth that they have beneath their ground and all the resources within them. They were a success of how you were able to combine white and black, living in unity, and that's what inspired, you know, the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa and all that. They did a lot of great things. So if this man is going to be the one that's going to usher a new change, a new era of new democracy in Zimbabwe, he has to do that. Already the people around the world, President, are congratulating Zimbabwe of this transition, and they actually want to help. We know there are Russia, China, and now I'm sure the US and Britain will come back and try and negotiate with Zimbabwe that was earlier on kicked off from the Commonwealth of Nations. Even the AU is going to come together to try and support him. Everybody wants to see Zimbabwe actually rise again from the ashes of Robert Mugabe's dictatorial rule. They actually need it, and he actually has to now draw in all manner of people from the civil society groups, people from the international community, not exclude people, and now have an inclusive government to see that he doesn't repeat what Mugabe did, but he starts a new trend of exemplary leadership for other African nations to follow too.
And Jermaine, what's in it for the people? We've seen Zimbabwean society largely repressed under Mugabe's rule, and then towards the tail end of last week, following that army intervention, they came out, you know, showing really more emotions than had been recorded of them. What's in it for them under the reign of Mnangagwa, at least for now, before elections hold next year?
Well, the new president will be coming in tomorrow. President Emmerson Mnangagwa actually said, you know what, he's going to be promising a lot of jobs, he's going to promise employment, he's going to promise opportunities for all, he's going to ensure that there's equitable distribution of the resources of the land. Now, this is, as we know, political rhetoric. People always say that before they get into office. But when he gets into office, he has to actually deliver on his promise, because everything is at stake. The people of Zimbabwe are the most important element when it comes. They are the ones who have suffered the oppression. They are the ones who have suffered from the high rate of inflation, as I mentioned earlier, and they are the ones who have had to carry one suitcase to go and buy a loaf of bread, one suitcase of, so to say, worthless Zimbabwean dollars to actually go and buy one loaf of bread in the supermarket. They are the ones who have actually suffered. And at this point in time, everything has to be done to see that their rights are actually being restored in the sense of dignity and hope, and there's also food on their table. They are able to lift their head up high and say, you know, whereas Zimbabweans, we can be the pride of Africa, we could feed Africa, and we could be a great nation, because there has to be a lot done for them, and it must be done by him.
Well, a new era and a fresh start for Zimbabwe, and it will all begin to unfold tomorrow as Mnangagwa gets sworn in as the new president of Zimbabwe. Jermaine Sonwolu, African Affairs Analyst, thank you for joining us on TVC News Hour.
Thanks a lot for having me.